Are you hungry? How about you? You want some food? This is the high track of Vancouver's downtown east side. This is where I used to work.
Broken people get recycled. What I thought was my way home.
I was traded from crack house to crack house, pimp to pimp. When I was 18, I didn't get dressed up to go to a prom. I had to get dressed up to go have sex with men.
Jennifer Allen.
I'm 33. I'm the founder, coordinator, and director of Jenn's Kitchen, which is an advocacy outreach and food relief service for women and their children. I've always kind of viewed the survival sex trade as like a bottomless pit, and I've been able to crawl out of that pit and I'm still alive. So now with Jenn's Kitchen, I go back into that pit and I'm able to extend my arm and pull people out. It's kind of like pulling someone out of a house fire. Imagine if you let go. I have about three main volunteers. I hook up with Kwantlen University and they have their criminology students that come volunteer with us. That's why I met my assistant, Melissa.
I've become quite close with Jenn last year, and I got set up with her through one of my classes, and I enjoyed coming out and doing outreach with her so much, and I come from a whole different lifestyle. Like, I've never experienced anything they experienced in the downtown east side, and I was like, you know what? I was like, this makes me feel like a good person.
Are you hungry? Would you like a lunch?
Was it a bag lunch?
Yes.
Well, thank you very much. I haven't had a bag lunch for about 20 years.
The most tender place in my heart is for strangers. I know it's unkind, but my own blood is much too dangerous.
Are you hungry?
Yeah, I am. I don't know why I haven't seen you yet before. I'm always sitting in these alleys. Actually, I'm always usually at that end over there.
So you guys, all you guys that want to do this shit for us?
Yep.
Like, not a lot of people really show appreciation for you, but I think it's really cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
Because not a lot of people give a shit about us now. I think we're all just junkies.
Some of us came from the same background. Like, I'm a former survival sex worker, and I've been clean for 7 years. So I know what it's like to be down, people don't give a shit about you.
Set you free.
Did you guys ever notice any of the murders and shit that happened up here? Did you ever see them on the news? Any stupid little thing like, oh, someone saw a bear in the city. It's on the news every day for like 2 weeks straight.
Mm-hmm.
But like, you know, like 4 months ago, we had 5 murders in a week and just in this area. And not one of those things on the news. Isn't that fucked up? Like, a 17-year-old girl got thrown off the median on the 7th floor. Splat, right on the fucking basis. Like, it's crazy. One murder is, like, fucked. 5 in a week?
Who will forgive and make me live again?
You just put a sheet over them and say, oh, just another overdose.
I know for a 16-year-old Aboriginal girl was murdered in Blood Alley. She was stabbed to death. And it took the police 3 weeks to decide if it was a homicide. Really? And then never made the news. Nothing. Nobody knows about it.
Since the late 1960s, 251 women have gone missing and murdered from Vancouver's downtown east side. What a lot of Canadian society doesn't know is that the Vancouver police would label the missing woman's file with NHI, which stands for a non-human individual, which means they have the equivalent of a dog. Now, who would waste their time to go looking for a missing dog?
Save me, please rescue me.
One of the recipients of Jenn's Kitchen was recently murdered. Her name was Carla Marie Smith. Her body was found in Deer Lake Park, which is in Burnaby.
A monster, it has done terrible things.
And then I tell Melissa, this is just the reality of the work that we do. We're going to have some people who are going to die on us. We're going to have to go pick people up and have them buried. And a running joke with Jenn's Kitchen is, we'll support you when you're coming into this world, and we'll support you when you're leaving.
I set you free.
It was very interesting how Jenn's Kitchen got started. I really wanted to do advocacy work on behalf of survival sex workers because I've been through all this hell and all this horror and everything. I wanted something good to come out of it. So before I go out to the stroll, I prayed to God to send guardian angels to watch over me so I wouldn't get murdered that night. And I'd go stand on the street corner. I literally would live life hour to hour. You're in such survival mode, you don't know if you're going to be, you don't make plans for tomorrow because tomorrow may never come. You don't know if the drugs can kill you or if a bad date can kill you.
Well, I heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord.
My defining moment as to when I had to clean up was when I was sitting with my drug dealer, and it was 1:30 in the morning, and I was sitting in someone else's piss, high on my mind, paranoid.
When it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth.
I was always be surprised looking at my watch. I'm still alive. It's an hour later. So you continue on to live life for another hour.
Hallelujah.
I just got sick and tired of being sick and tired. I just got sick and tired of the paranoia, sick and tired of just being scared, sick and tired of the poverty, just. This is not the life that I wanted to live.
Hallelujah.
In 2004, I had an epiphany and I realized God didn't invent me to be a drug-addicted survival sex worker.
Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her baby.
So I went down to the Union Gospel Mission and I detoxed for 4 months straight on their floor. And then 6 months later, I had to leave the survival sex trade because I got attacked by a pimp. And I remember him saying to me that I wasn't important, how he could get away with killing me. And that's when it clicked in. He's right.
And she tied you to her kitchen chair. And she broke your throne and she cut your hair.
And that's when I realized that I need to change my life because this is ridiculous. I didn't care if I died during my detox because I wasn't going to go back to using.
I look at where I was and where I'm at now and I realize how far I've come and I'm very happy I'm in a safer place today than I was 10 years ago.
Hallelujah!
Yes, you have to want to change. You have to want to make sure you have a future. No one's going to hand anything over to you. As I've said, you have to fight and kick society in the teeth to get what you want.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I'm actually kind of happy I went through the poverty, homelessness, drug addiction, survival sex, child sexual exploitation, because it made me a stronger person who I am today, and it gave me this whole education, and I got to see the reality of what discrimination looks like. And now I have an injustice I know I can fight against. I have the knowledge, I'm equipped with the knowledge to fight it.
When you're not in a place of constant survival, you can actually dream of what your future will look like.